Good morning, my name is Pier, if I haven't met you yet. I'm currently the Late Church Student Minister and it's a real joy to be here. It's a real joy to be part of Late Church as well. I'm going to begin with our Bible reading, and that can be found in page 1142, and we'll be reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 to 17. So the reading again, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 to 17. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people, together with all those everywhere who call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God for you because of his grace given you in Christ Jesus. For in him you have been enriched in every way, with all kinds of speech and with all knowledge. God thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. Therefore you do not lack any spiritual gift as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will always keep you firm to the end, so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. My brothers and sisters, some from Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is this, one of you says, I follow Paul, another, I follow Apollos, another, I follow Cephas, still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius, so no one can say that you were baptized in my name. Yes, I also baptized the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I don't remember if I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not with wisdom and eloquence, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. Please join with me as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are awesome. Father, we thank you for the message of the gospel. Now we pray that you would give us ears to hear and eyes to see. Help us to understand your word. And I pray, Father, that you would transform us. Father, help me this morning to be faithful to your word. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, for some of you who don't know, I grew up going to church. I've heard many Christian words over my time, and I'm sure you have too. Yet one in particular word that I often heard growing up was the word gospel. So I wonder what enters into your mind when you hear the word. I wonder what it stirs up. You see, you may have grown up in church or been around often enough to know it's a word we use frequently, or you may be new here this morning and you think it's a weird foreign Christian term that has little relevance to you. You see, the gospel is the biblical narrative of what God has done to reach us in entering into the world in Jesus Christ to achieve a salvation that we could not achieve ourselves. But my fear is that we can easily lose sight of its beauty and importance. That maybe to some of us, the gospel has just become another bit of information that you can read from any website, blog, book, or magazine. Simply a set of systematic beliefs for Christians. But you see, the gospel is so much more than just information. The gospel is transformation. So this morning will be a first talk in a two-part series called The Power of the Gospel. We'll be looking at how the gospel is more than just information. So I encourage you, if you have your Bibles there, please keep them open as we read through it from verse 1 again. So it says, Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God and our brother Sosthenes. Now you have to understand and marvel at who's actually writing this letter. Because this guy, Paul, was not your stereotypical Christian. He didn't grow up in a Christian home and who loved hearing about Jesus as a child. It's quite the opposite. What is remarkable is that this man once tried to destroy and eliminate Christianity completely. He wasn't born some crazed fanatic either. He was a Roman citizen born in the provincial city of Tarsus. He came from a prestigious family line in accordance with his Jewish heritage. He was highly educated, intellectually brilliant. He was incredibly disciplined and devout. He excelled beyond a lot of his peers. And as a Pharisee, he was most likely meticulous with his prayer life. He was meticulous with reading the scriptures, fasting, tithing, you name it. He did the religious thing better than most of us can. Yet he hated Christians. And he hated the gospel message with every fiber of his being. So much so that he actually thought he was doing God an important service by trying to destroy and eliminate Christianity. So what changed? Because right now in this letter, he just calls himself an apostle of Christ Jesus. And he would later become one of Christianity's greatest champions, greatest thinkers, and greatest missionaries. He would walk around the ancient world planting churches. He would go through many trials, heartaches, suffering, and loss for the sake of telling others about Jesus. He would write a major chunk of the New Testament, and he himself would describe his life in this way. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. Even more than that, he writes that all things in his life are considered rubbish in comparison to knowing Jesus. So what happened? What changed him? To put it simply, the gospel. Paul had an encounter with the living God. You see, the gospel doesn't simply educate a life. It transforms it. The gospel isn't merely a set of beliefs that Christians have to believe. It is so much more. The gospel isn't information, it's transformation, because the gospel is about a person, a relationship. You see, what you get in the gospel is God. You encounter the risen Savior. It is this fact that makes the gospel transformation. And Paul understood it with a vicious clarity. That the gospel wasn't lifeless information, but the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. So Paul lived, breathed, slept, and spoke the gospel. He saw the gospel translate into the everyday mundane existence of his life. And it's key to understand this about Paul if you're going to understand what he's going to say to the Corinthian church. He was a man transformed by the gospel. Read with me, picking up from verse 4. I always thank my God for you because of his grace given you in Christ Jesus. For in him you have been enriched in every way, with all kinds of speech and with all knowledge, God thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. Therefore, you do not lack any spiritual gifts as you eagerly await for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will also keep you firm to the end so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Corinthian church struggled just like a lot of us do today. They felt the pressure of the world they lived in. The culture, the city, the values, the hopes, the pursuits. They felt an uneasiness and were worried that somehow they were missing out on something in the gospel. You see, it's easy to think Jesus isn't enough when you compare him to your context. I mean, is Jesus going to pay your mortgage? Is Jesus going to make your job better? Is Jesus going to fix your marriage? Is Jesus going to get you better grades? So they felt the tension that maybe they needed something else. Possibly that new car. Possibly that new iPhone. Maybe if you just change your jobs. Maybe if you just had more money, that will satisfy us a bit more. Maybe if we did up our house or bought a house. Maybe if we had a promising retirement. You see, the Corinthians understood, like all of us, that innate human desire to find satisfaction and fulfillment in life. It isn't any wonder why the advertising industry is booming. It plays on that. Do you know why we buy things we don't need to impress people we don't like with money we don't have? Is it because we really are living a fulfilled and satisfying life? So here Paul reminds the Corinthians about the sufficiency of the gospel. That life in Jesus is sufficient in every way. That he is all we need and could ever want. You have been enriched in every way, he says. That there is nothing lacking in him. You see, somehow we think that because we have a stagnant spiritual life, we need something more. You see, Paul understood the pressures the Corinthians faced. They lived in a growing, bustling, cosmopolitan city, a city that praised wisdom, eloquence, giftedness, wealth, and status. And within that context, they were to believe that the gospel was and is enough. Can you start to see and imagine the tensions that would arise from that? We aren't different, are we? I mean, our very own culture celebrates tolerance, or a very skewed view of it at least, that you can hold whatever belief you want as long as you don't try to share it or claim exclusivity. Yet we believe that Jesus is the only way to be saved, that in him is the fullness of life, and that we are called to repent of our sins, that there is a way that there is a way to live life that honors God, that there is a way to live in our marriages, our sexuality, that honors God. We believe that God will one day come to judge, that there is a hell for those who reject him. Can you start to feel the tension in your own heart as the clash of cultures happen? Yet Paul understood that the gospel was so much more than what this world has to offer. So he reminds them of the sufficiency of it. You see, the gospel, the great news of Jesus, translates into the everyday of our lives, the mundane things, the getting up and getting down, the sleeping, the eating, the joys and the heartache, the pleasures and the pain. The gospel engages our suffering and our brokenness. And Paul says the gospel satisfies and fulfills. You see, it's easy almost to think, like the Corinthians, they had their own challenges, that maybe intellectually something more was needed. For those who don't know, I've been studying at QTC, or the Queensland Theological College, for the past 3 years. We've intensely been looking at the Bible, theology, exegesis, engaging with apologetics, philosophy, critics and scholars. Let me share a secret about my time at Bible College so far. After 3 years of Bible College, we're still learning about the gospel. And I don't even think we've scratched the surface. It's easy almost to think as well that spiritually something is missing. I know that as Christians, many of us struggle with our own personal Bible reading and prayer life, or maybe I'm alone in this. Yet that doesn't mean that nothing spiritual is happening. I mean, our struggle isn't against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, authorities, powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. I'd be shocked if we didn't find praying and Bible reading hard. You see, it's easy to think that in our experiences we're missing something. I want to be honest, I don't always have fluttery, moving experiences when I come to church. I love coming and being with God's people, but I don't always feel like cloud nine when I do. I've got two little kids and I love them to death, but trying to get them out of the house, can I just say, I don't arrive at church with the best mindset all the time. But can I tell you, I don't need to go somewhere else to experience something to remind me that it's good. So Paul reminds them that the gospel is sufficient both now and in the future. That God hasn't held out on them or us. So Jesus, is Jesus going to pay the mortgage? Is Jesus going to make my job better? Is Jesus going to fix my marriage or make life better? Yes, by transforming our lives. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that you will magically wake up one morning and have money in your account to pay off your house. Although you'll wake up tomorrow finding your job or your work enjoyable. Or that your marriage will instantly be problem-free. Or that your life will be easy. Far from it. Rather, what you will find is that there is something that will engage these areas of your lives and transform it. And that is the living God. That is why the gospel is sufficient. That is why it is satisfying. That is why it transforms. You know what I love about these Corinthians? You might not love it about them, but I kind of do, is that they were broken, messed up people like you and I. I love this about them because it reminds me that the gospel is for us. It reminds me that in the gospel, it isn't about how awesome we are or how together we have our life, but it's about our awesome God. I mean, when did church become a place where we have to look like we have it together? When did church become a place where we have to pretend everything is fine and easy in order to make Jesus look good? Because it isn't. No. How does Martin Luther put it? Aren't we all beggars telling other beggars where to find bread? So I love that these Corinthians were raw and broken people because it makes Paul's pursuit of them with the gospel so much more beautiful and real. But don't get me wrong, I don't celebrate that they did wrong things, but rather I celebrate the hope of those things changing. Because the Corinthians got some really, really wrong things. Let's read one of them. Verse 10, and we'll see how the gospel changes it. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. My brothers and sisters, some from Chloe's household, have informed me that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is this, one of you says, I follow Paul, another I follow Apollos, another I follow Cephas, still another I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? Alexander the Great once united, if you don't know Alexander the Great, lived quite a long time ago. He united all of ancient Greece, a feat no other leader had done before him, and united all of the Persian Empire together under his banner. He basically did this by conquering them, building the best of Greek culture into their cities, while kind of allowing them to keep their own cultural identity, and then he moved on. So he'd conquer them, put some Greek culture into their cities, and then move on. And this remarkable thing happened, this weird phenomenon. All the cultures that he conquered wanted to incorporate Greek culture into their lives. It's what we called Hellenization. Yet though the cultural culture lingered after Alexander died, the unity didn't. When he died, that unity within all those places he conquered broke. In 1934 to 1945, Adolf Hitler united Germany under a Nazi regime by making it a totalitarian government. In other words, a government that had complete control over public and private life. He united Germany, all right. It just caused a Second World War and was the result of the Holocaust, which killed over 6 million Jews. Unity is something that has been fought over for thousands of years. Yet I want to ask the question, How does anyone go about uniting a world with all this diversity? Can unity occur in the midst of such diversity? You see, sadly, the Corinthians had forgotten the majesty and the beauty and the sufficiency of the gospel. They just lost sight of it. And the moment you lose sight of the gospel, division occurs. When you think that the gospel is not enough, division is the result. So division was occurring with the Corinthian church. Basically, this is what was happening. They began following particular leaders over and above others. So depending on their strengths, one would follow Paul, the other Apollos. I like how this guy preaches. I like how this guy speaks. This guy is friendlier. This guy is more approachable. This guy is funnier. See, they began to create a division within themselves that should never exist amongst the people of God. You see, the gospel breaks down every social class and social prejudice. It confronts any racial tensions and breaks any racist view. It destroys discrimination, removes partiality, and unites people under one common hope and purpose. The gospel creates unity with diversity. How? Jesus. Jesus is what unites us. He is what unites our diversity. So it doesn't matter whether you're male or female, black or white, whether you're born in Peru or Australia. It doesn't matter whether you have a six-digit income or you live in poverty. Jesus died for us, all of us, while we were yet sinners, while we were his enemies. He came to make us his people, a people from every tribe and nation, a people who would confess that Jesus is Lord and gladly and willingly live their lives for his glory and renown. You see, Jesus sees all our gifts and talents. He sees all our faults and failures, all our weaknesses and complexities, and he unites them in his life, death, and resurrection. A unity that this world has never seen or heard of outside of him. So Paul reminds them of the gospel. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized into the name of Paul? Of course not. So he goes back to the gospel, verse 17. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not with wisdom and eloquence, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. So how do we do life together if we are so different in all so many ways? If you haven't quite got it, the gospel. So then when you are hurt by someone in this community, and you will be hurt by someone in this community, we are broken, sinful people. What happens when you apply the gospel, when you see the gospel, is you don't just leave or hate them. But rather you are reminded of the reconciliation, the forgiveness that Jesus showed us on the cross. All of his closest friends abandoned him. One of them betrayed him. They beat him and mocked him. And yet on the cross he says, "Forgive them, Father, for they do not know what they do." So when there are people who are difficult or needy, and you think, what do I do with that? Remember the gospel. That in humility and love, Jesus became one of us. So that he may love and save us. He endured our suffering, our hardships. He ate with us. He spoke with us. The gospel reminds us how to be humble when there are people we find difficult. It's not saying that it's easy. Just the gospel transforms the way we do life. If you find life difficult, Jesus understands that and engages with it. He gives us his spirit to work within our hearts, and we don't do community alone. We do it with Jesus. Not only that, but he unites us with all our gifts and our abilities. So, in other words, the person who leads at the front, or me who is preaching, I just want to make this clear, I am no more any special or remarkable than the worker who handed you a Bible this morning, or the mother who's trying to control her kids at the start of the service. It's usually my wife. Yes, God gives us different gifts, different talents, different interests, different roles, but all of those are understood in the context of encouraging, building up, growing each other, God's people. The gospel life, the transformed life, has removed the emphasis of self-promotion, self-centeredness, social status, racial prejudice. The gospel makes a new people united in diversity, a people from every tribe and nation, a people who seek to love and serve Jesus, a people who would seek to serve and love others, a people who would engage the broken and needy, a people who would be bold in proclaiming the gospel, a people who would breathe, eat, sleep, and live the gospel. You see, the gospel transforms us and unites us. It is God's work. This is the power of the gospel. And my hope is that you never lose sight of that as a church. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love us. We thank you for the gospel. And we ask that you forgive us for those moments where we think the gospel is just not enough. But Father, we pray that you would remind us of the beauty and the majesty, the life and the transformation we have in the gospel. Father, help us to see our King Jesus more clearly every day. And we pray this because we love you. Because you love us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.